Welcome back to Shop Talk. I'm Raquel Rodriguez. We're talking about shifting careers. We now have with us Drexx Laggui, president and CEO of Laggui & Associates. Before setting up his own company, Drexx was an engineer with an IT firm, and he was based at one of the world's technology capitals, Silicon Valley. Hello, Drexx. Thanks for joining us on the show today.
Glad to be here.
Now, you worked in one of the world's, as we said, technology capital, Silicon Valley.
Yep, and I enjoyed every minute.
How long did you work in the corporate world before becoming an entrepreneur?
Oh, okay. I started out in 1993 when I was still a staff writer. I found out at an earlier age that I'm an engineer who can actually write.
Okay. Now, prior to having your own business, what other jobs have you held?
So I got to be a staff writer for Computer World, writing news about computer stuff. Then I got to be an engineer with Comfac Corporation.
Wow.
And then when the internet started booming, I was with Sun Microsystems.
Okay.
Did the firewalls and stuff, and you know, security was like a buzzword, and you mentioned the word firewall and people would come running.
Yeah, it sounds like a federal agent.
I know. No, I don't have a lifestyle like just like what you see on TV and CSI.
Right.
No. And then after that, I got pirated by the Israelis. I moved to Singapore, but that was just like my official home address. Mm-hmm. I was traveling all over. I would like accumulate about 100,000 miles, at least 200,000 miles, airline miles in Singapore Airlines every year.
Wow. Now, the software technology company that you worked with was also like ranked on NASDAQ's stock market. So it's a pretty huge company to work with.
Yep.
Why did you decide to leave the corporate job and come home to the Philippines and start your own business?
Oh, wow. It's kind of a corny reason. I kind of felt guilty about the brain drain in the Philippines.
Okay.
I contributed to that. So I said, you know, I was, you know, camping one night in the Sierra Madre in California, and I said, I should go back home, reverse the brain drain, help the economy, help the, you know, give back to society,
right,
contribute to the community and stuff like that. So I did, and other reasons were that, you know, I made a bit of money in the NASDAQ, mm-hmm, not just with my own company, but other stuff. And armed with a little bit of capital, I decided to move back home and try my own luck.
Wow. That is amazing. Was the decision difficult for you?
Oh, definitely.
Because I can imagine there is probably a lot of IT wannabes or budding computer engineers that would love to be in the position you were in. How was this the decision-making process for you to leave that?
It wasn't, you know, a snap-on decision, but mm-hmm, it was more like things started happening and there was a tipping point eventually happened. Basically, it was difficult because I was enjoying my job.
Right.
I had, you know, the Filipino American dream, actually.
Right.
Multiple cars, a nice house in the Bay Area, and friends. We were active in communities and stuff like that. And I decided, you know, I'd rather... There, you're a small fish in a big pond.
Right.
Working with the world's best make you feel a bit, you know, not the brightest student in the shed.
So what were some of the adjustments you had to make to go with that shift from going from a corporate world to being your own entrepreneur?
All the pitfalls I went through?
Yeah.
Oh, a lot. I mean, for one thing, I came from a corporate world, right?
Mm-hmm.
I was one of those engineers, the escalation engineers,
right,
as we call them. I was given a lot of toys, expensive toys. Anything that could reflect how our clients worked, what they had,
okay,
they could give it to me. Mm-hmm. Instantaneously. I mean, I had a laboratory just for me that cost tens, if not $100,000 of worth of equipment. Now, I got spoiled. Being my own boss, I decided I had to count my own pennies.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I had to justify if I'm going to buy this equipment, I'd have to, you know, justify it. There has to be economic reason behind that.
Right.
That's one thing. And I had learned how to be patient, to actually listen to customers.
Right.
And not just build cool stuff that I thought, you know, would be, hey, you'd like this, but actually solve problems that they were trying to, you know,
now,
bring to my attention.
Now, tell us a little bit more about the business that you started.
Oh, it's a professional services company. It's unlike any other company that went before it. Meaning, we just did professional services, like we did penetration testing, and I get a lot of jokes about that.
What's penetration? I was going to ask, what is penetration testing?
In layman's terms, online banking systems, mm-hmm, banks hire us to do professional hacking.
Oh, okay.
They hire us. Ever seen the movie Sneakers?
Yes.
That's where I'm patterned. You know, Bishop and Associates?
Okay.
Laggui and Associates.
Now, for those who aren't familiar with the movie Sneakers, explain to us a little bit more about...
Well, I'm nothing like Robert Redford. But what we do is that banks would know that there are bad guys out there who are very clever. Cleverer than, you know, their internal IT people.
Right.
And they need to test that. Mm-hmm. They need to test their defenses. They need to test their controls. So they hire us to test that.
Okay.
It's better for us to find out what the problems were than for the bad guys to do so.
Wow.
And so far, I could really, up to this date, we have had 100% success in all our client engagements when it comes to penetration testing.
Now, this is a really specialized type of business. What made you decide to get into it?
Well, one thing is that I've heard some people were doing this,
okay,
but they weren't doing it properly. And I'm going to get busted for this, but I sometimes refer to them as pedantic jokers who have a lot of alphabets appended to their name.
Right.
But the thing is, we are computer scientists first. Mm-hmm. Then we moved to IT audit. Therefore, that gave us a big advantage in understanding how to test the systems. Mm-hmm. We have an innate knowledge of how systems work, and our mentality is how do we break down that system so we could actually test it. So we have that kind of background and skill. That's where we came from back in 2005 when we started. And it was hard selling at first because nobody knew us.
Right.
You could only know about me if you do a Google search and how I contributed throughout the years since the 1990s. And that's how people started to trust. And then, you know, in the banking industry, it's all about trusts. Mm-hmm. And once you get into that circle, they started, you know, snowballing.
Right. Now, in your IT audits and penetration testing, have you encountered any fraudulent activities?
We have simulated fraudulent activities.
Okay.
We have hijacked routers across the internal network. We have written into databases. You know, we have actually opened up credit card numbers.
Wow.
We have, remittance systems, right? When you send padala, right? On your phone, you'd have a control number or remittance number, and then the amount which you bring to bank and claim your money.
Right.
You're identified by your name, ID, and phone number. We have actually manipulated and also fund transfers.
Now, how has the business been since you started in 2005?
2005, the first few years were tough because nobody knew us, but we had a contract and we had computer forensics contracts in between. And you know, if my advice for other engineers who are going to do this, you better have, you know, some good money stowed away,
right?
Because it will be a long rainy day until you get the trust of the community. Then you know, cash flow would come in.
Now, in addition to preventing fraudulent activity, what are some of the rewards that you've received in being in this business?
Okay, for computer forensics, we've helped out in homicide cases, so we had a lack of appreciation from the Department of Justice in Cebu. We've done the forensics in the recent elections. We went through that PICOS machine that was stored in the Senate, and the output of those of our report helped give the Senate and the Congress the assurance that Pinoy could be declared as president.
Now, the PICOS system is fairly new here.
Yeah.
So what are the challenges that you've also encountered with that and with the business?
Nobody trusts it. they had a lot of trust issues, and it was pretty much a black box. But when we started to reverse engineer it, and we found it, it has a lot of similarities with regular computers. And we worked on that.
And what are the main challenges that you've experienced in your business?
I could go back to trust again.
Trust.
Okay. And another one is that the maturity level of many organizations are very low when it comes to IT or computerization efforts. So if they're not that dependent on computers,